This video is brought to you by Skillshare. Become a member for free for 2 months with the link down below. Last year, I showed you my love for this thing, the Lattepanda Alpha. This tiny Raspberry Pi-like computer hides a full Windows 10 PC with a laptop M.3 CPU and 8 gigs of RAM, making it potentially one of the most interesting tiny low-spec computers out there. You can watch the original video I did about this computer on the corner, but long story short, I had received one of the new versions of this computer which introduced what on paper is a slightly better dual-core CPU, and to balance that, it limits the RAM to single channel, which kills integrated graphics performance, although there was still a fair deal that could be achieved in terms of gaming. I ended the video by commenting on the M.2 port on the back of the device and that I will add an external GPU and do that video soon.
That was 5 months ago. What happened?
Lots of things happen. Turns out, sometimes adding a GPU over M.2 is a bit of a hack and not quite a seamless experience. Here's what I have learned so you can make better decisions. On the back of the Lattepanda, there are two M.2 ports. They're becoming more and more common as the main port for expansions, even on cheaper computers, which stuff like mini PCIe relegated to older components. While each port will vary in the type of connections it allows, they often have PCIe lanes, meaning that they can be used for expansions like SSD, Wi-Fi adapters, and sometimes, if you're lucky, you can even get an external GPU connected in there. Easy, right?
Wrong!
You see, there's not one type of M.2 port, they come in 12 freaking variants depending on the location of the notch, and while in practice there are roles for each variant, also known as key, and therefore you will rarely see most of them, not every cable, adapter, and device that you see online specify which key does the cable use. Case in point, and Gwent and both online, a bunch of M.2 to PCIe adapters, mostly from Amazon Spain, which had a very limited selection, without checking the images to confirm details. This was not a good idea. 90% of all adapters available on Amazon are from M key, which is the right one on the Lattepanda, and they turned that to PCIe X4. Thanks to the magic of the PCIe interface, you can perfectly connect a full X16 GPU to a tiny X4 interface and have it work, just with limited bandwidth, which is all the bandwidth that the M.2 key M port can deliver anyway. But to connect a full GPU to the adapter, you needed to have an open-ended PCIe slot, not one of these slots that has a piece of plastic blocking it. At the moment of purchase, I could not find an open-ended adapter, so I tried to have a friend help me cut a hole to get the GPU connector in. This did not work well. Since the pins are so close together, it was extremely difficult not to damage them, even with some expert help. So the solution was to bit the bullet and get an open-ended adapter from China from AliExpress, and leave my destiny in the hands of the Spanish customs god. Eventually, I did manage to get my hands on a couple of working ones. To make this adapter work without a riser, the Lattepanda has to be set backwards, which does make checking status lights a bit difficult, but it does look really cool with the GPU on top. However, the GPU cannot be powered from the M.2 and requires external power through these pins. If you are industrious and crafty enough, you can modify a powerful enough supply to connect it here. If you are not, they usually come with a Molex or SATA adapter to connect to a PC power supply. The one problem with that is that since the motherboard connector is not plugged in, the power supply will not turn on automatically with the PC and you will have to short a couple of pins manually, which is easy, but yeah, a bit of a hassle to set up. Which is why I literally end up plugging it into the power supply of an entirely different PC I had running in order to test this. This is probably the most wasteful setup I have ever done, I am well aware. Another alternative that was surprisingly readable in Amazon is the Exp Gdc. If you're a longtime fan of the channel, this might seem familiar. This is a full PCIe base that connects to some sort of PCIe access through an HDMI port? Sure, PCIe over HDMI, the gentleman's thunderbolt. That makes absolute sense. And you can find this extremely weird HDMI cable implementation going to one of three things. Mini PCIe, which is what most old laptops use and the ones I use in my ancient video about connecting an external GPU to a netbook. Then there's a connection to Express Card, which you can find in another set of older laptops, and M.2, which is the cable I bought for this video. On one side, the EXP, it's its own contained unit, so you do not have to put the Lattepanda in any weird position, and it connects and powers up a PC power supply easily without the need of shorting pins, and is, in general, way more comfortable to work with. The M.2 connector cable is a bit too short for the Lattepanda, so I cannot securely screw it. There are adapters to deal with that, but I'm done buying stuff from AliExpress for a while, so I'm just going to, you know, I'm sure this is going to be fine. Now the real problem that you might have zeroed in on this M.2 connector is that it uses the E key, so it can only be connected to the other slot on the Lattepanda. And this one only has 2 PCIe lanes versus the 4 on the M key connector. So even though you're plugging the GPU in a full 16 lane connector, in practice you're getting, at most, 2. And Windows chose just 1. What does that mean? That the amount of data the PC can get to the GPU is limited, and therefore it might not use the GPU to its full potential. Don't worry, I'm going to experiment more with that in a second. Now, you will believe in any of those 2 adapters, it's just a matter of putting the GPU in, turning the Lattepanda and installing drivers, right? Nope, wrong again. Oh, that would have been just too easy. Connecting a GPU over M.2 can be a bit of a finicky process. With both adapters, the whole setup didn't exactly just work with any GPU I tried. The NVIDIA GT1030, it doesn't even boot. The NVIDIA GT1050, it boots and lets me install drivers, and then epically blue screens when I try anything else. What about the AMD RX 550? This was an okay sub $100 GPU choice not that long ago, as it stood between the GT1030 and the GT1050 in terms of power, and it is still a great choice if you can find it for less than a GT1030. More importantly for our experiment, it works and is stable over the connector, so we will proceed with that. So now, let's test exactly what are we sacrificing when using the slower but more comfortable port. I wish I could say something like half the bandwidth means 30% less FPS or something, but it is not as simple, especially when working with budget GPUs, and it will massively depend on the game. For any game, there are a number of things that could be a limiting factor in its performance on a specific GPU. If all the other elements of the GPU are doing fine, and the CPU is not causing a bottleneck, then the bandwidth is 100% going to be a problem. Here's a great example. CSGO continues to be a relatively light game in terms of GPU power, so the RX 550 is going to do fine. To my surprise, the addition of a dedicated GPU really allowed us to use the CPU to its full potential, and it turned out to be enough for testing scenarios on this game, and that means that for sure the limited bandwidth is going to be a problem. So, the community benchmark map over the one lane E-key adapter, 69 FPS average. Not bad at all. Over the 4-lane M-key adapter, 125 FPS average.
As the people in my Discord will say, big oof.
But hold on, because matters change dramatically on any game that forces the GPU at all. Case in point, I run the benchmark on the original Tomb Raider, which tends to be light on CPU usage and can make this GPU sweat a bit more when in the high settings, which still look pretty amazing even now. Since now we're not dealing with potentially hundreds of frames per second, the difference in bandwidth barely makes a difference. So, for the frame rates I expect from the games I will test, I am going to stick with the lower bandwidth adapter, just because it makes the setup way easier to handle and I'm tired of using weird systems to power it up. I'm sorry. If there's an M-key adapter for this space, I will be sure to find it eventually. Especially consider that the CPU is still the main limiting factor for pretty much everything that I tried except CSGO. Here's Rocket League at 1080p on a higher graphical preset and at 60 FPS cap. The RX 550 is having no trouble while the CPU seems some heavy use and occasionally cannot keep the 60 FPS lock. This is still a terrific result and an absolutely wonderful experience for this game that I can see myself turning to. However, I could not help but notice that for a lot of videos out there doing the same experiment with an older version of the Lattepanda, they were getting better frame rates. This is a bit odd, given that the CPU on this one is supposed to be an upgrade and the result was consistent no matter which M.2 adapter or game I was using. So what's happening? I am not sure. The world of low TDP mobile CPUs is at times weirdly inconsistent. It did still overperform my expectations. For example, here's Apex Legends at 1080p. The M3 CPU was bravely capable of maintaining over 30 FPS on this game, even during combat, which, while unideal for a competitive shooter, is enough to actually fend for myself, as you can see. This is not precisely the lightest of competitive shooters, so this is definitely a great result. If anything, I kinda wish I had set a more reasonable FPS limiter to improve the overall pacing. Overwatch, on the other hand, tends to be somewhat lighter than Apex while also being more manageable at lower frame rates. Considering how badly the game did when I tried playing it on an integrated GPU and how I was unsure if the stuttering was caused by a lack of bandwidth on the integrated graphics or lack of power on the CPU, I can now very safely say that the CPU was not the main problem. The RX 550 was an excellent match for Overwatch, as I could use medium preset graphics at 1080 with still plenty of space left over. The CPU was chugging along, keeping the game anywhere between 30 and 60 FPS, but in general, the game felt just playable enough, definitely a leg over what I expected. So, should you get an adapter and start connecting GPUs to mini computers with M.2 ports? Depends. You need to be aware that this whole thing is a bit of a hack, so you have to be comfortable with random things not working and having to fiddle around with power supplies. But if you're comfortable with that or crazy enough to even build your own custom power supply for the adapter, then owning something like this base is actually a pretty interesting investment. After all, I have seen members of the community and fans of the channel build some really cool stuff using similar methods, and the results speak for themselves. And definitely try this on other devices soon. Now, if you have the idea of using a mini PC as your mobile workstation, which can occasionally use an external GPU to freelance, work, and find your fortune around the world, you might be interested in acquiring the skills to work from anywhere. Like this class on how to write better JavaScript, a tremendously useful programming language, the one programming language that I ever actually got decent at, and one that took me surprisingly far. This is a class hosted by Christian Hillman, a superstar on web development. Funny story, years before I started YouTube, I did a bit of volunteering on Mozilla, and I had a chance to briefly meet Christian personally when he worked there. And I can certify that any course made by him is worth looking at. This is one of many courses you can find on development, entrepreneurship, freelance, animation, graphic design, and many, many other cool skills at Skillshare, this video sponsor. Skillshare is a community for creatives and lifelong learners, with classes that include a combination of video lessons and a class project. Skillshare has classes to fit your skill level, and most classes are under 60 minutes with short lessons to fit any schedule. If you become a member of its community, you gain unlimited access to thousands of inspiring classes with hands-on projects and feedback from a community of millions. An annual subscription is less than $10 a month, which is incredibly affordable, especially when compared to pricey in-person classes and workshops. And the first 500 of my subscribers to click in the link in the description will get 2 free months of premium membership so you can explore your creativity. This is a limited offer, so get it while it's hot and get started on your digital nomad dreams. Thank you to them for sponsoring this video and you for watching.